I remember it being very warm that afternoon of May 22, 1992. Me and about 20 other people who crammed into my father's hospital room on the 10th floor, the cancer floor, of Baptist Hospital in Little Rock. Just that morning, I had taken my final exams for my junior year at Malvern High School and went on with my usual business. It wasn't until I was picked up at the high school by relatives who lived out of town that I realized that something was wrong. I knew my dad was sick. I knew he was dying. But I didn't comprehend that this was his last trip to the hospital. In my immaturity, I did not equate that a frail shell of a man being wheeled out of his house on a gurney meant that he would never return home. I thought maybe that my mom just could no longer take care of him and he was being moved to the hospital to be treated until he recovered to a state where he would someday return home. Nobody spoke of him dying at the time he was taken away. Nobody wanted to say those words. Somehow, we're able to muster the strength to watch someone wilt and fade, but it's nearly impossible to talk about it. It's too hard. It's too painful. I stepped off of the elevator and onto the 10th floor of Baptist Hospital, walked down the long, quiet hallway, and opened the door. You see on shows on TV where a man is dying and there is one woman quietly weeping at his bedside as a song by The Fray softly plays in the background. But that was not the scenario for my father's passing at all. It was shoulder to shoulder, standing room only. These people weren't crammed into a small hospital room to watch a man die. They were there to pay their greatest respect to a man who loved and adored them. And they were now saying goodbye to my father by showing their love and adoration to him on this, his final day. Close family was there. My mother and brother were there. Many of my aunts and uncles were there. Cousins, friends. My father knew no strangers. Everyone he came into contact with was sure to remember him. He had a Cheshire smile and a laugh that resonated throughout a room and would reach deep down into your soul. Of course, many of us hold our parents in the highest regard, but my father truly was special. He played with all of the children in the neighborhood and was like a foster father to those who didn't have caring, compassionate dads. At the time, I didn't realize just how special that was. He was just daddy to me. I thought that all daddies played with their kids and showed a sincere interest in their activities. I thought all daddies hugged their children each night and told them that they loved them. I thought all daddies were warm, compassionate, and caring. It wasn't until I was much older that I realized that not everyone was fortunate enough, as I was, to have grown up with the man who raised me. I stepped inside the room and joined them. Although my father was dying, he was quite awake for a man who had one foot on this planet and the other foot in another realm. I could tell from the look in his eyes that he was very pleased that so many people had come to pay great respect to him. My father had grown so weak that the words he muttered were inaudible. But that didn't keep him from speaking. He had something special to say to many of us in the room. We knelt down and put our ears to his thin lips as he each gave us instructions on what we were to do after his passing. I don't remember what he told my mother and brother, but I clearly remember what he said to me, as if I had just heard it this morning. "Take care of your mother and brother," my dad whispered with one of his last breaths. "I will," I said with all the strength the teenager could possibly have as I was watching the man I admired most in this world fade away. I hugged him gently and stood up. Then Dad looked over at the window and muttered something that we all thought was incoherent. But someone, possibly my mother, leaned in and caught what he was saying. "Snow?" she asked as if she didn't hear him correctly. She then turned to the crowd and said, "He says it's snowing." Now, in case you didn't know, it hardly snows in Arkansas but once or twice every couple of years, let alone in late May. But that was not enough to stop our logical thinking minds from turning us around. Everyone silently turned simultaneously toward the window. Slowly. almost as if we didn't want to see that it wasn't snowing. After all, they did not want to indirectly call a dying man a liar. Everyone gazed out of the large picture window on the 10th floor of Baptist Hospital. Nobody said a word. We just stood, staring into space. Some of us contemplated our existence, while others of us stared into the fair blue sky and took a moment to breathe. But the silence was soon broken with an abrupt exclamation. "Heaven!" an older lady in the group exclaimed. "Robert sees heaven! He sees heaven! Heaven!" The shouting of the woman didn't startle the crowd. In fact, everyone seemed to concentrate harder, staring out of the large gaping window in an effort to see if we could catch a glimmer of the pearly gates. I don't know how long we stood there. Could have been minutes, could have been hours. What I do know is that we were all looking at that same fair blue sky. To this day, nobody who was in that room has ever spoken a word about our encounter in the cancer ward on that clear, late spring day. But there is one thing that I do know for sure. That's the closest we all have ever been to heaven, and will be, until we, like my dad, one day watch it snow in May.